everybody. Wow, the volume's up. Now that you're awake, what a great crowd. Thanks for coming today. Of course, we have other things going on here at the museum that you should also come to. Next week, we have much to learn about aviation in the First World War. And you're probably asking yourself, what does that have to do with anything at Gibson? And we will, at that point, be between the shows, so we can explore all kinds of things. And that, of course, is on July 5th. And so we're kind of focusing on something that, kind of has something to do with July 4th. And Saturday, July 8th, is Saturday Sketch. And that is from 10 to 11. And that's during our free time. And so you can come in, and Sonny Montgomery is going to be the guest instructor. So come on for that. And of course, that's the free time. But if you are a member of the museum, you can come in to all kinds of programs for free, including Lunch and Learn. So if you're not a member, you might want to think about becoming a member. And today we're so lucky to have Brian Pera. He is a filmmaker living in Memphis, and his film project, Only Child, is part of an ongoing film series called Woman's Picture. And Woman's Picture and a related fragrance line, Tableau de Parfum, were awarded ongoing support in 2012 through a grant from the Creative Capital Foundation. So help me welcome Brian Pera.
I guess the only thing that really qualifies me to talk about perfume is that I love it. That's really my only credential. And I'm not going to talk too much about myself in the beginning, because I have a very ambitious roster of slides to get through. How's that sound? How's that? Better? No? I'm going to go by through decades, and I have not picked, I've tried to pick about two per decade. Again, I'm no authority, so they're not the quintessential perfumes of that decade. They're just ones that I think are interesting to talk about for whatever reason, and I'll try to clarify that going through. There's going to be a lot of smell going around, so if you get headaches or you get migraines or anything like that, or you might vomit or something, I probably will not enjoy this. So, and I don't think you will either, neither of us will. So I'm just warning you that it's going through. There's also some coffee that'll be in passable jars. Don't snort too hard because it is granulated. And Helen is my friend. She's going to play a perfume lady who wanders the department store floor giving me these things. And she'll probably do two per row, and you'll pass them back to the person behind you. And maybe just after things are over, if you want to smell something again, you can come up here and we'll try to figure out how to allow you to smell them again. Please don't touch the bottles. I'm way too anxious a person to have 30 people up here picking up things and putting them down. No offense. I'm sure you're all lovely. But I get really high strung. So I'm going to start with the 80s and 90s. And this is a picture of Santa Maria Novella, which is a very old perfume house. I think it dates to the 1860s. I'm not sure. It's an old, what looks to me like a church. And at the time, I'm not starting, let's say if we were to break down this exhibit, I'm probably starting around that third room, starting with the 1880s. Before then, perfume was made, but it was mostly solo flores, which is like a single flower note. It was kind of strictly for the wealthy. And those bottles that you see in the first two or three rooms in this exhibit were not made necessarily at that time by the perfume company that generated or produced the perfume you were wearing. You would buy them as sort of a piece of art that you put your favorite perfume in. And that's where in time this is. You go and they have them in all these, bottles. And they were, like I said, they were mostly single flower notes because that's what was acceptable to wear if you were a woman. If you were a man, it was like a cologne, which was a mix of herbs and citrus, basically. It's meant to sort of be very evanescent and not last very long. The types of perfume now are eau de cologne, eau de toilette, eau de parfum, and then the perfume extrait. And what that means is that has to do with the concentration of essential oils in the fragrance. Eau de cologne has the very smallest amount of concentration, and it's meant to be sort of a refresher. So that's what men were wearing at that time. They were not supposed to be walking around wafting scent all the time. It wasn't accepted. So this is another picture of Santa Maria Novella. This is I'm sorry, I can't date this picture, but it's probably around the time we're talking about. It was a very private thing that she did as a woman with fragrance. You would do it in your boudoir, so to speak, at your vanity. And you did not perfume your body, you perfumed a handkerchief, which this ad helpfully instructs you as a consumer to do. You didn't put it on your skin, you had it on your person. Or you might, I think, put it on your clothes, but typically it was strictly a handkerchief affair. And so this was the first. Actually, would you pass out that iris and the violet? So the two that she's going to pass out first are not the two I'm talking about right now, but they're both Santa Maria Novella fragrances, which are still made today. They're not older, unfortunately. The form, you know, it's a modern form of an older fragrance, because I wasn't alive in the 1860s and not many people were. And this is an example of a single flower note that you, as a woman, would wear when this fragrance came along. This was made by Hildegard. It was Fougere Royal, MC. And Fougere is basically fern, as you can see by the ad. And it had basically, you know, it's when you smell it, you'll recognize it as kind of the classic barbershop scent. It makes a little bit of herbal, makes a little bit of citrus, and it was a male fragrance. Let me see. So I wanted to, you know, tell you, the writer Baudelaire identified seven qualities of a perfume, and you can sort of judge as we move through these, whether any of these hit those marks, I don't have them all, so sorry. But one is that perfume is non-figurative, and it defeats efforts of language and metaphor to encompass it. He tried anyway. He wrote a lot about perfume, and we're going to try too, but you can decide for yourself how lucky we are to kind of get at what these perfumes are. Along the same lines, the philosopher Julia Priscilla wrote, "Enveloping, atomizing, enrapturing, perfume resists being signified. It conjures worlds. It forms alliances with metaphors. Poetry is the language of musk, ambergris, and incense." And by the way, nobody wore musk, ambergris, and incense at this time. It was considered, you were ill repute if you had these sort of animalic scents on you. Thus, these flowers that are passing through, which are lovely. So around this time, this was released in 1882, and around this time, there was a novel that came out right after this, 1884, which was called Against Nature, and it was basically the inspiration for most of the decadent artists like Oscar Wilde, Aubrey Beardsley at the time. And they were the character who is the protagonist of this novel, Against Nature, or Against the Grain. I'm not going to try to pronounce the French. I looked up a lot of the French on YouTube this morning, so we'll see how much I butcher it, but I'm not going to try this one. But the protagonist of that book was called an olfactory dandy. This is an example of what that would have come in. Very beautiful bottle, with again a fern signaling what you're supposed to be smelling. This is the novel, the Poisson's novel. I'll try it anyway. Our Door. Maybe that's it. Against Nature. And the decadents basically celebrated artifice. And they celebrated, they really, against nature means sort of, they believed that nature was unreliable, it was too mutable, And if you created this artificial pleasurable domain that could be relied on and it was better than natural, that book influences. Here's the reason this cover, this version, has this turtle on it is because the character in the novel gets a turtle somehow and decides it isn't good as it is, and he covers it in jewels. Yeah, someone tried to do it in real life, apparently, and a turtle naturally died. So Oscar Wilde apparently wrote Picture Grey based on, or inspired in part by this book. And in fact, there's a book in the novel that's referred to as that yellow book. And at that time, books that were illicit or, you know, kind of signaled to you the way the ferns on that box do, if it was yellow, that it was questionable reading. Which, of course, he celebrated. And there's the door. This is obviously a much later cover. Most people think that the novel is kind of about aging and the inevitability of decay, and in a way it is. But it also fits very much in line with their aesthetic, which was sort of hiding nature and elevating things and masking them and kind of shutting out reality in some other place that could be controlled, would be kept free in the room that you were in, or the psychological room. This is a periodical that was put out, it was originally edited by Aubrey Beardsley, who's an artist, too. On the cover is showing, of this particular edition, is showing a woman at her vanity. I don't know if that's a powder puff, a flower, or a drug paraphernalia that she's holding, but clearly that's perfume.
We can count on that being perfume on the actual vanity.
Very expensive.
Yeah.
The dandies, apparently, or the decadents, despised their era's, quote, deep aversion to perfume, quote, which I really relate to. They saw perfume and saw things of beauty as also possessing the quality of decay, because there is no beauty that's not in transition. It's all fleeting. So that was kind of encapsulated in anything that they admired or revered, was this sense of both presence and absence. The absence meaning it's not going to be that way. Whatever it is you're encountering now is not going to be there soon. And I go through this sort of detour to... There's Oscar Wilde and Alfred Douglas, who is his lover, who sent him to prison, basically. And their dress and posture and everything is sort of quintessentially dandy or decadent. That's Aubrey Beardsley in his sitting room. And so, right after Fougere Royale came out, Fougere Royale was sort of a new thing, and it like most of, or many of the perfumes we'll talk about, it used some synthetic. It capitalized on some synthetic, which is a polite word, maybe saying chemical, but so is essential oil, for that matter. But, you know, This synthetic would come out and the perfumer would capitalize on it. And it would also, because it was something new, be something slightly radical to the nose of that period. Both Fougere Royale was a little less of that. But they both had coumarin, which is a synthetic derived, coumarin is actually a chemical compound in a lot of fruits. Foods. It has sort of vanilla hay-like quality to it. And vanillin is sort of more of the same, maybe slightly inflected differently. But those two chemicals or synthetics were what gave Jicky and Fougere Royale sort of their distinctive new quality. Fougere Royale is closer to the cologne or aftershave that men and women both are accustomed to men wearing. Jicky was sort of a new thing, and I think, you know, that climate of decadence and climate of change allowed it to emerge. It also affected its reception, because Jicky particularly was marketed to women, so it was taking this Fougere idea and translating it for women. is Aimé, I don't know how to pronounce it, Guerlain and Jacques Guerlain. The Guerlains are, until recently, a family of perfumers, and all of the Guerlains that we're talking about were created by one of them. Aimé, or how we say his name on the left, created Jicky, and there are two stories about why it was named Jicky. One is that it was his nephew Jacques' nickname. The other was that it was inspired by a woman, that a girl that he was in love with in school as a boy, who was named Jicky. So who knows which, but those are the stories. It was released the same year as the Eiffel Tower, and of course the Eiffel Tower is beautiful and almost pedestrian, unless you're standing right in front of it at this point, because you've seen it represented so many times. But at the time, if you just look at the buildings around it, you see how radically different it was. Not just scale, but shape. And Jicky was, you know, the landscape of perfumery or fragrance, kind of similar. But this is, I think, an earliest ad for Jicky, and it shows what they must have hoped would happen, which is that, you know, it's something that could be shared between the genders, the sexes. She has another handkerchief. She's also sitting side saddle. He's not. And he's clearly enjoying the fragrance, and it's kind of bonding them. That's the bottle, which I'm not sure if this is in the exhibit or not, but that was done by Baccarat for the Guerlain firm. At the time, like I said, this iris and the violet, the violetta that's passing around. This was the Victorian culture of these flowers. They all said something, they all meant something. And this is something that a young woman might have had, so that if her beau sent her I can't see these from here, but a pink rather than a violet, she knew what the heck he was trying to say. You probably can't read them from here, but I can't either, so. This is just sort of a little illustration of the bottles, and illustrating also that they both share this synthetic material of perfumery. Coubertin had done something novel, like I said, but within the sort of structure of what was expected. Whereas Jicky, which came out in 89, just 5 years later, did something pretty radical compared to things by comparison. It also had animalics in it. Which one are you passing around right now? Is Jicky and Kuna? Okay. So this is the civet cat, and they still put civet, not the cat itself, but secretions from its glands, put it that way. And so there weren't many animalics, which is what this and musks would be called, animal-derived ingredients in fragrance at the time. And another thing that makes Jicky a little radical is that you weren't smelling like a violet, you were smelling essentially, excuse my French, like a cat's ass. Yeah, just a little bit, just a touch. I started looking, you know, at the time. It's not that I've never seen a bustle before, but I kind of wanted to know what landscape this fragrance was arriving in. And I was shocked to see how much underclothing was required to create this shape. And how sturdy some of it was. I mean, this is a whalebone. And so you're talking corset, you're talking, you've got mutton chop sleeves, you've got a big thing here. You've got this over that, you've got that over that, and you had like 8 changes a day, which were not elected. They were, if you were going into the sitting room to greet guests, then you were wearing a very specific thing, or you were the hooker, basically. This shows the old style, which is also restricted, and the new figure, which was ample in both the bust and derriere. And the hair was up. This shows what that waist, the idea that she manages to look at all relaxed is astonishing to me. She's just taking it in stride. She's not standing, but she's taking it in stride. This was a dress in the 1890s by Charles Worth, which shows you sort of an elevated, it's a wedding dress, so it shows you a very formal version of that. But even those sleeves require, like I said, scaffolding to hold something up. It's very uncomfortable.
I'm very thankful that my mother did not raise me having to wear this stuff.
So we have a very complicated relationship, and I wouldn't blame her. This is two other dresses.
This is a modern hat for Jackie, which I think is fascinating when you compare it to the original hat, where she's sitting sideways on a horse with God knows what sort of scaffolding her up underneath. Holding that handkerchief like it's the most relaxed, languorous thing. This is a woman behind the wheel, expressing self-agency and self-determination. So that's 1800s. Let me check really quick and see if I just skipped anything. So the writer Alan Corbin in the 90s wrote that every 50 years or so musks and ambergris unleash short counter offenses. So things like civet, like musks, they're acceptable for a long period of time, then they come back. And you'll see that as we move down the table. But at this time they were not acceptable, and they certainly weren't standard. Okay, so moving into the 1900s, there were a few relaxation of the scaffolding.
You could swim if it was recommended by doctors, and it was very short, I'm talking about as a woman, and very covered up.
So it would be for your health, but not for your comfort. And you could greet people in a tea outfit that allowed you to sort of loosen your corset, not remove it, but loosen it. So all of these restrictions are still in place. And heavily socially enforced, presumably, as you move into the 1900s.
This is the World Exposition, which happened in Paris,
I think in 1900. I'm going to say 1900, I can't find the date.
And it was basically a celebration of artistry, innovation, craftsmanship in France. This is a selection, from the exhibit of glass. And there were many, many different booths in this exposition. And one of them was created by Malik. It was in the perfume pavilion, they called it. He created this 50-foot-tall, basically crystal perfume fountain, and around it in this octagonal room, various perfume houses exhibit their bottles much like the Dixon is currently exhibiting it. If you haven't seen it, I encourage you to, because it's gone after this weekend. 1900, World's Fair Exposition.
By the time that this exhibit took place in the perfume pavilion was shown, there were 300 manufacturers for fragrance in France. It's a major industry. And there were 2,000 real retailers, and there might have been that many realtors as well, we don't know. And 20,000 employees in this retail outlets. One observer called the Labig sculpture, the fountain, the work of a musician. So at this time, the perfumes, whatever they were, by the way, at this exposition said to be pretty banal. They were still sort of the floral thing. So the flasks they came in were gorgeous because glass was kind of hitting its stride. But the perfumes were pretty pedestrian. They were sort of more of the same. And at that time, every perfume had a line or a family. So they offered it in soap and powder, just this whole line, which Estee Lauder still does. And Guerlain, all of them still do that. They're not utilized as much, but it sort of gave an entry point for every consumer in every socioeconomic demographic within a very limited spectrum. During 1890 and 1900, Guerlain alone launched 10 perfumes per year, each year, which is a lot. It was a lot then, and it's a lot now, really, for one house. originally was doing jewelry and used the, I forget the, what it's called. I can't remember what the, what that is, the technique they use, but it's a technique mostly used in jewelry. It involves casting, and he started sort of doing that in glass. And once he sort of hit up this collaboration with Cody, was doing very well, he basically abandoned jewelry. Cody's factories at the time employed 4,000, his warehouse was 54,000 square feet, and he claimed that they could produce 100,000 models a day. He was also sort of a perpetual liar, which is why he's such a good one. I don't know, just that maybe that helps him be a good one. Baudelaire again wrote a piece called The Flask, and that talked about the perfume bottle as kind of the instrument of memory par excellence. It's a singular force of resurrection, transforming absence into presence, a sort of coffin housing the memory of vanished things. So it's not just, if you think about scent, it's not just that perfume that you think about when that bottle is, whatever that smell evoked for you at the time you wore it. The exposition was dominated by Art Nouveau.
These are sort of illustrations of the sort of Art Nouveau aesthetic. It's also showing you that single flower things are still very much in evidence. This is Violet. And also women have gone from being, at least in these advertisements, from being these very rigid structured creatures to very floaty, mysterious, you know, amorphous creatures. Still creatures. But this shows again that it's still at the time customary to fragrance your handkerchief, not your soul. The titles of most of the perfumes around this time were equally sort of pedestrian. You know, wind of violet or orange or rose, or you know, they let you know that it was a flower you were dealing with. And that kind of changed with Guerlain's opera L'Envie, which is After the Rain. And they like perfumery with synthetics sort of entering the picture, were allowing for a more poetic, abstract approach to perfumery and the image systems around perfumery, the kind of fantasies that they created for you. That's not a really specific thing. After the shower, after the rain means different things to different people, but it evokes a fantasy or a fantasy realm in your mind. Fashion changed a little bit too. Paul Poiré, this is 1910, but his first corset-less dress was 1906. So things were sort of relaxing a little bit. He was a designer, but he also had a line of perfume called Parfum de Rosy. I don't know how many of those. They're still around, but they have a different owner. It's not his perfume. So the 1910s. So I'm going to sort of focus on two Guerlain fragrances. This is a Cody, but it inspired a fragrance by Jacques Guerlain, the Jicky, from Jicky, presumably, to create Le Bleu, which is the Blue Hour, another poetic name. It's not Blue Narcissus, it's not Blue Peony, it's Blue Hour, similar to After the Rain, sort of conjuring this strange poetic metaphorical realm. Wearers and consumers' mind. It took its cues from, again, this fragrance by Cody called L'Oregon, and it came out in 1912. I can't remember when L'Oregon came out, unfortunately. It was released prior to World War I. Again, the bottle is Baccarat, and it's one of their still famous bottles with the inverted heart stopper. During the war, they had to cease production of this bottle. They returned it with Mitsuko, which is a fragrance I'll talk about in a second. But it is still manufactured, even in the Eau de Parfum, in a bottle that is, it has a plastic cap, but it's still this bottle. This is Monet, and it reminds, a lot of Monet's work in the Impressionist in general reminds me of Little Blue. It's a very sort of dusky, gray, twilighty. It's that period between the sun setting and
So it's sort of the magic hour. The core of this scent,
are you passing on? Which ones are you passing on?
They're blue and the core of the scent is iris, orange blossom, heliotrope, vanilla, aniseed, and tonka. So you can see that's already an abstract composition. It's got things in it that are much more than this really limited specific floral thing. It gradually took on more melancholy associations because possibly due to the lower, which follows in after. And Catherine Deneuve was sent to a morgue for years at that. Though she was associated with, she kept being associated with different Guerlain fragrances besides that, like Chamade, which came out in 69. And it's a very different fragrance and a very different image system in the name. Chamade is like the fast fermented heartbeat, so it's a much more active, sort of passionate perfume. And Lore Bleu is very close to the vest and kind of buried under clothing and flesh. The scent of heliotrope that you're smelling in this is sometimes compared to almond. Isn't that right, Susan? Do you know? No? Okay. The florals of this fragrance to me smell somewhat withered and waxen. Like it's got this gray pall over it. Very beautiful, but it's very melancholy, very kind of quiet and serene. And there's kind of a gauziness to it, and also a medicinal vibe, slightly. It did employ vanillin, like Jiffy had, and Fougere Royale before it.
This is an early ad for it, or a mid-stage ad. This is the famous Blanche bottle. Usually that would have cologne came in that. That was another beautiful bottle, and it was massive, because you need more cologne, because it lasts less long. This is Jiki with his, you can see the scent strips on this little wheel mechanism he has. And so he's testing out his formula and various components of it. Take weeks, months to make a fragrance because you have to let it sort of sit and mature and saturate and all that. There was another picture of him with a book writing down his formula. So again, it is orchestrated opulence. It's like this formula. It's based on science. It's based on art. It's based on intuition. And it's a very long, painstaking process. Most of the time. This is Mitsuko, which came out in 1919. And it was based on a book called Bate, say that's it. It's based on that book. it was meant, the perfume, to sort of capture an impossible love, sort of these feelings of joy mixed with angst, or not angst, that's probably not a great word for a perfume system, but like, something suppressed. Something bursting out and something kind of held close or inhibited. And the novel was about the wife of a Japanese, I think, general? Let me see if I can find it. A Japanese admiral. She falls secretly in love with a British officer during the war between Russia and Japan. Kind of about this impossible love from her point of view toward it. It was also a variation. Here's an ad for it. Are you her type for Walker London? All these colored ads for their perfumes, asking if you were her type based on this perfume. And here's the Cody fragrance that was sort of inspired by. Shepherd is what Mitsuko is. Those technically a Floriental. Shepherd is inspired by the island Cyprus in Greece, I believe. And it's, again, it was a new structure. New formula at the time, and it's still around today. And basically contains milk moss, patchouli, so it's got this really woodsy undertone to it. And top notes are usually citrus, bergamot, something like that. It also has labdanum in it, which is an animalic smell. And it has usually a sheeper, though not so much anymore, has a real animalic thrust somewhere in it. There are many, many subcategories of Shepherd. There's fruity Shepherd, there's some leather Shepherd, some of which smell of fruity Shepherd. This used a synthetic called persicol, which
peach skin quality, and makes it basically sort of touching into that fruity chypre category. Writer Susan Irving said that Mitsuko smells the way God intended women to smell, plush, trembling, and golden.
This is a consumer buying model with a size that I would kill for. Mitsuko. This is the wash with the bottle again. This is Catherine Deneuve and Boone Wells, Belle de Jour. She breaks the bottle in her bathroom before setting out to, she's a housewife, and sets it. Before setting out to a day of prostitution in a secret brothel, she breaks this bottle. That was the 60s, by the way. So, different times. It also features, both of these feature the classic Guerlainade accord, which was a bass, a very complex bass, of very many different ingredients. It kind of was their signature throughout these, especially these Jean Guerlain fragrances. Mitsuko has kind of entered into, it's been embraced by a lot of artists, it's been in films like Benoit. Here it makes an appearance in Dinner at Eight. It was said to be Jean Harlow's, one of her favorite scents in real life, but it was also in this film. Charlie Chaplin apparently loved it. Diaghilev of the Russian Ballet was said to sort of saturate the fragrance with it, which is my style. I like that. And then this was also released in 1919, and it's a very different smell. It kind of, this was a smell made for women, and it is a tobacco leather. And if you wore this, you were a ill repute, and you wanted to make it. Shows you kind of what the flopper was up against. They were supposed to be this virtuous and this sort of made up, yeah, and interchangeable in a second. So, like, this is a flopper, so I mean, you know, it's right around the same time there. This is two floppers smoking. I like to think they're wearing two flopper blondes. And we're into the 20s. This is sort of the look that was emerging, and Gabrielle Chanel had a lot to do with that. This is not her at the time, but this is. Cigarette's still there. Still tough. And Chanel No. 5 was her first fragrance. It's really the only one, aside from No. 22, that I'm going to talk about for the 20s. Chanel famously was quoted as saying, "I make fashion women can live in, breathe in, feel comfortable in, and look younger." And I think that quote definitely took on richer meaning for me when I looked and
Tao was, you know, sort of following Poirot's lead and dropping the waistline. She was using jersey, which was really a men's underwear. Fabric. And all kinds of, you know, men's tailoring was entering into her looks, and it was all about comfort and elegance for her. So you might have heard the quote from Marilyn Monroe when somebody asked her what are you wearing to bed at night or at night, and she says 5 drops of number 5. And I showed you how iconic that fragrance is, because I think that was in the 50s, so 30 years later or something. But I never read the entirety of that exchange with this interviewer in, I think, a Tokyo airport. He was asking her, basically, what do you wear in the morning? What do you wear for brunch? What do you wear? So he's, like, referencing that customary thing, even in the 50s, of women having all these outfits for certain social things. And that, you know, when she's going through all these answers and saying, I wear a sweater and a skirt, or for that, I wear a sweater and a skirt, and then she ends up at 5 drops of Chanel. To me, that's so radical when you consider what women have been wearing and been forced to wear and how many times they were changing. And her answer is so effortless and provocative and about her own pleasure, presumably. I mean, I'm sure other people were sometimes in bed with her and enjoyed it too, but it's mainly about her. So number 5 is an aldehyde. It's a floral aldehyde, and aldehyde there are many different kinds of aldehydes, but it often has this powdery quality. You probably don't even need to smell Chanel No. 5 to sort of remember what it smells like if you've smelled it. It's a many scents have that floral, or in that floral category at the time, there weren't many. And Ernest Poe, who was the first, this shows you Chanel's outfits, by the way. This was one of her famous black dresses, little black dress. This is a coat. Flappers were called flappers because at the time young women left their coats open to flap, which again is like, it's radical when you think of where they had just been 20 years or so before, where everything was shut up, buttoned down, scoured it up, cantilevered. And this shows you sort of the difference. This is in 26. Number 5 was released in 21, so this is a little later, but still, it's not that much later. This is a very beautiful dress that probably has a lot going on underneath it. And there's Marilyn. Sorry, I kind of forget the slides. So aldehydes, again, have this sort of powdery quality, but they also are said to give a lift to a fragrance. So if you've got it in flower or floral arrangement or abstract floral arrangement like jasmine, orange blossom, whatever, and you set it against aldehydes, it kind of has the effect of this picture, which this picture is probably referencing. It seems to sparkle. It is a synthetic, and Ernest Beaux, who was the creator, there are many stories about Chanel No. 5 and sort of why she picked this, because he presented her with like 15 or 20 options. They were all numbered. I think like 1 through 5, and let's see if I can find them. Yeah, 1 through 5 and 20 through 24. And they said she picked 5 because it was almost the fifth in her new line was about to debut or whatever. But number 5, as novel as it was in the marketplace, was actually based on a perfume that Ernest Beaux had done for a Russian perfumery that had gone under during the war. There was a lot of money in Imperial Russia, and when that went under, he was out of a job. I think he even served in the military. And his perfume was discontinued. So she would have known that, Chanel would have known that this, you know, had been in circulation. He probably tweaked it a little bit, but he probably didn't have to tweak it much, because most people at that time, even now, don't make it over to Russia. This is an early ad. Again, shows a woman, you know, pretty liberated from restrictions and, you know, sort of constrictions, so to speak. This is later, number 5, showing a sort of assertive, telegraphing sort of assertive qualities. This is number 22,